Can You Forgive Her? By Anthony Trollope. Read by David Shaw Parker for Naxos Audiobooks. Volume 1. Chapter 1. Mr. Vavasor and His Daughter. Whether or no she, whom you are to forgive, if you can, did or did not belong to the upper 10,000 of this our English world, I am not prepared to say with any strength of affirmation. By blood, she was connected with big people, distantly connected with some very big people indeed, people who belonged to the upper 10,000, if there be any such division, but of these very big relations she had known and seen little, and they had cared as little for her. Her grandfather, Squire Vavasor of Vavasor Hall in Westmoreland, was a country gentleman, possessing some 1,000 a year at the outside, and he therefore never came up to London, and had no ambition to have himself numbered as one in any exclusive set. A hot-headed, ignorant, honest old gentleman, he lived ever at Vavasor Hall, declaring to any who would listen to him that the country was going to the mischief, and congratulating himself that at any rate, in his county, parliamentary reform had been powerless to alter the old political arrangements. Alice Vavasor, whose offence against the world I am to tell you, and if possible to excuse, was the daughter of his younger son, and as her father, John Vavasor, had done nothing to raise the family name to eminence, Alice could not lay claim to any high position from her birth as a Vavasor. John Vavasor had come up to London early in life as a barrister, and had failed. He had failed at least in attaining either much wealth or much repute, though he had succeeded in earning, or perhaps I might better say in obtaining, a livelihood. He had married a lady somewhat older than himself, who was in possession of 400 a year, and who was related to those big people to whom I have alluded. Who these were, and the special nature of the relationship, I shall be called upon to explain hereafter, but at present it will suffice to say that Alice MacLeod gave great offence to all her friends by her marriage. She did not, however, give them much time for the indulgence of their anger. Having given birth to a daughter within 12 months of her marriage, she died, leaving in abeyance that question as to whether the fault of her marriage should or should not be pardoned by her family. When a man marries an heiress for her money, if that money be within her own control, as was the case with Miss MacLeod's fortune, it is generally well for the speculating lover that the lady's friend should quarrel with him and with her. She is thereby driven to throw herself entirely into the gentleman's arms, and he thus becomes possessed of the wife and the money without the abominable nuisance of stringent settlements. But the MacLeods, though they quarrelled with Alice, did not quarrel with her à l'outrance. They snubbed herself and her chosen husband, but they did not so far separate themselves from her and her affairs as to give up the charge of her possessions. Her 400 a year was settled very closely on herself and on her children, without even a life interest having been given to Mr. Vavasor, and therefore when she died, the mother's fortune became the property of the little baby. But, under these circumstances, the big people did not refuse to interest themselves to some extent on behalf of the father. I do not suppose that any actual agreement or compact was made between Mr. Vavasor and the MacLeods, but it came to be understood between them that if he made no demand upon them for his daughter's money and allowed them to have charge of her education, they would do something for him. He was a practising barrister, though his practice had never amounted to much, and a practising barrister is always supposed to be capable of filling any situation which may come his way. 2 years after his wife's death, Mr. Vavasor was appointed assistant commissioner in some office which had to do with insolvents and which was abolished 3 years after his appointment. It was at first thought that he would keep his 800 a year for life and be required to do nothing for it, but a wretched cheese-paring Whig government, as John Vavasor called it when describing the circumstances of the arrangement to his father down in Westmoreland, would not permit this. It gave him the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.